And these guys got through playing over the weekend here in Kansas City. And if you will, they referred to it as soul-influenced psychedelic southern rock. They're headed for St. Louis tonight after they get through down in Studio A, the Marcus King Band, live here on the bridge.
You know, we always appreciate it when a band gets up and drinks a couple of pots of coffee and gives us some music first thing in the morning. It's really something special to have a band dedicated enough to come in and do this for us. Marcus King Band, brand new album out on Concord as of this October. Thanks for coming in, guys. Really appreciate it.
It's good to be here, man.
Just hearing spectacular things about the show last night at Knuckleheads. You had people up on a Sunday night shaking it.
Yeah, we had a good time. This was our first time in Kansas City, and I think people took to it pretty well.
Yeah. You know, you're out of Greenville, South Carolina.
Yes, sir.
Musical family. Mm-hmm. The guru, Mufasa, your dad.
Yeah.
You actually were a sideman for him for a while?
I was, yeah. I played with my dad from the time I was about 8 years old until I was about 14 years old. So I had a lot of club experience, you know. Playing with him, and that led me to wanting to start my own configuration when I was about 14.
So how close was his music to what you're doing today? He was kind of a blues guy, wasn't he?
Yeah, he's more straight ahead, you know, and he's still doing his thing, you know, and whenever I'm back home, which is pretty rare these days, but whenever we're back home, we like to jam together like we used to.
How about your grandfather?
My grandfather was a real country gentleman. And that was the name of his band, actually.
So it was like just traditional country?
Yeah, it's country and western, both kinds. So he really schooled me on a lot of the country stuff. But the real early country stuff, like Hank Williams, is really reminiscent and really relatable to like the early blues stuff too, just as far as the song formations and like the emotion behind it. So I had both schools of thought there, but the same kind of emotion.
Yeah, you know, when I'm getting ready for an interview, every once in a while I'll find one story that just to say, okay, this is all you really need to know about the artist. And I found one of those with you, and I just love this. You got into trouble when you were 7 years old, mm-hmm. and your dad gave you the choice between a spanking or giving up your guitar for a week.
Yeah.
Your choice?
I took the licks, man.
The guitar is like your best friend.
Yeah, it's always been like that, especially when I was young. I didn't have a lot of friends. I was pretty introverted. I still am, you know, but these are my brothers here, you know. So I grew up really as my guitar and my grandfather and my dad being my best friends, and as well as my sister, and we all played, so I just spent all day doing that.
You know, the thing that I also love is that sort of music as therapy thing.
Yeah.
Is like, you know, that sounds like a really inward thing, but you turned it outward and your music is now therapy for others.
Yeah, man. I've had a lot of people come up to me about my writing and it's helped them, and that's been my goal. You know, it started as, you know, trying to act as therapy for myself, and it's starting to help others, which is really a beautiful thing for me to realize. And that's the most important thing about it for us, is to express our emotions, you know, externalize that, because I think with society, the way it's kind of breeded us is to kind of repress our emotions, and it's really, really not a good thing. That's what causes a lot of really, you know, hateful acts in this country that we live in today. And it's all about outward, you know,
yeah,
releasing your energy in a positive light.
Well, we could not be more excited. Marcus King Band in our studios this morning, and we'd love to hear a song if we could.
You got it, man.
Oh,
That was pretty great. Okay. Really enjoyed that. That was Self-Hatred, right?
Yes, sir.
That you had Derek Trucks guest on that one.
Yeah, we sure did, man. It was fun.
Yeah. Boy, I'll tell you, your playing is just spectacular. You know, by the time you were 8 or 9, you kind of knew that you wanted to do this for a living, right?
Yeah, man. I was, you know, I felt pretty lucky that early on I was really, really aware of what I wanted to do the rest of my life. And that became really evident when I was in high school and I had all, you know, my classmates really kind of freaking out, you know, trying to figure out what they wanted to do with the rest of their lives. And I think George Carlin was the one that said, like, you know, you got kids that are asking to go to the bathroom and they're supposed to decide what they want to do with the rest of their lives, you know, 1 month later. They got 3 months of summer to decide. And I've always thought that was nonsense.
Yeah.
But I felt like I was one of the lucky few that kind of had an idea of what I wanted to do. And, you know, regardless of which path I took, which was I really wanted to go to school, but, you know, senior year just wasn't there for me, man. I just had to get on the road. I was really antsy and felt really, you know, unappreciated at my school, you know, and they all kind of saw me as like this dropout loser almost because I was out playing most nights. So I was really tired when I got to school. So, you know, I just made that decision for myself, but not to be said, the other way is cool too.
You know, it's interesting to look back on that now that you're in your old age.
Yeah.
What were you, 20?
20, yeah.
Pretty amazing.
Still got the X's on my hands.
Yeah, can't drink, right?
I wanted to put my age on my hands, Roman numeral style.
you actually did take some time out to do, of all things, some jazz theory, jazz performance study.
Yeah, that was while I was in high school. I think that was the only thing that kept me through. For my sophomore and junior year, I was studying with Steve Watson at the Fine Arts Center in Greenville. And Steve is just an incredible player, very knowledgeable. And our bass player, Steven, actually attended the Fine Arts Center as well. And really incredible plays. And it was like every movie you see where kids are actually happy to go to school, that's what the Fine Arts Center was. We all went there for the second half of the day. It was a privilege to go there, you know, because you had to have like a straight A average or else they'd give you the boot. And he taught me a lot. And you might recognize him from such themes as Hill Street Blues and the A-Team. He was a session player for a while. And Transformers, too, yeah.
Well, now you've got me.
Yeah. But Miami Vice, all those real, like, sorry, Steve, like those cheesy 80 guitar tones yeah. That really cut through. That was Steve, man.
Yeah. You know, the funny thing is that it's like people always want to try and put a name on things. And you know, I don't think music really needs that. You guys are kind of a stylistic melting pot.
Yeah, you know, that kind of happened inadvertently, you know, to us. And we kind of embrace that now because we feel that, like you said, music shouldn't really be put in any kind of box or any kind of category. Like I said before, it's just an expression of emotion. And however you want to express it, but we try to put some kind of confines on how we describe it so people don't come expecting a polka band and we do what we do. So I think we started calling it like soul-influenced jazz fusion psychedelic southern rock.
Yeah, that just rolls right off the tongue.
Yeah, you know, and, you know, file under that, and everybody loves saying that.
Yeah, you know, the last couple, 3 years have just been, you know, when you're trying to tell this chronologically, it's like, how do you jam that into a couple of years? You put out a debut album, and really the only player left from that first release is your drummer.
He's the only one that made it.
Yeah. And my guess was that during that time, the way that it reads out, it was sort of like you were sort of making mental notes about who was in the next incarnation.
Yeah. Yeah, that's certainly true. Because I've known Matt maybe a little longer than I've known Jack. just from playing around town. And after the first record, that was kind of like the indicator was, I guess I never really thought about it, but the whole time our bass player was with us, he was in college and studying, you know, computer programming. So when he graduated, you know, he was going to make a lot more money doing that, at least for the first few years.
Right.
So he had to split, which was understandable, and he's still a good friend. And our keyboard player went to graduate school. That's the one that really got me, because I was like, you finished school. What are you doing? And he was like, I want to be a teacher. I said, you're going to teach music? He said, no, I'm going to be an English teacher. I said, well, that's just ridiculous. But he's still a good friend, and he's doing his thing. And Matt was moving back from Oakland at the time, or the Bay Area, and he needed a gig, so we were like, all right. And Steven, our bass player, he was in the band before he knew he was in the band. We had a guitar player friend of mine that was getting ready to move to Boston to attend Berklee School of Music. And I went and saw his band, and he had Steven on bass. And I was like, man, what a killing bass player. So I asked him, I said, can I have your bass player? I like your bass player a lot. And he said, yeah, I'm moving. He's going to need a gig. So
it's like a free agent acquisition.
So
yeah.
So I kind of told Steven, I was like, hey, man, let's do this.
You're in our band. Sorry.
And he said, all right, let's go. I said, you got a P bass? And he said, yeah. So that's how it started.
You know, when you hear the music now, it just seems like this is so obvious. But Warren Haynes is like an hour away. And you had mutual friends. And I imagine a fair amount of reverence for him, because he's a spectacular guy in just about every way. But your friends kind of floated him a little bit of your music and started a whole nother sort of little odyssey.
Yeah, that was really exciting times for sure. I spent a lot of time in Asheville, North Carolina, which is where Warren was born and raised. And I had a lot of friends up there that I was riding with and singing with and playing with at the time. And I didn't know they were Warren's, like, school buddies, you know, and, like, riding mates and stuff. So they all really dug what we were trying to do. And they told me they wanted to introduce my music to their friend Warren. And I was like, all right, yeah, that's cool. And then it was Warren Haynes. I was like, whoa, all right, that Warren. Cool.
Yeah. So he invited you to play his Christmas jam, which is just, you know, not a lot of local musicians on that bill usually. It's like big name acts. Did you know that he was at some level sort of vetting you?
Yeah, well, no, I didn't really have that in mind until afterwards, because we got invited to play at the jam by day, and we were in this small club playing, and it ended up being quasi like an audition for his management company that's run by Steph Scamardo, and they dug it, and we've been working together since.
What was it like the first time? Did he just jump up on stage and start playing with you, or did he ask? Because he's jammed with you some.
Nah, you know, in Asheville, North Carolina, during Christmas time, he's like the most sought-after guy within a 100-mile radius, you know, unless widespread panic's in town. And everybody's really trying to get a piece of him, so he didn't make it to that, but they sent a couple scouts out, kind of.
Yeah.
And then we all kind of met together and talked about what we wanted to do, you know, as far as artist development's concerned. We all had pretty similar idea in mind as far as what my intentions were for this.
Yeah. Well, we're loving everything you're doing. We'd love to hear another song if we could.
Sure, man.
Her eyes. She was so tired, but her eyes remained open. So much to say, but her words remained unspoken. Weep not for me, for my mind won't hold no peace. She carried so much weight. Oh,
That was spectacular.
Thanks, man.
Really good. Rita is Gone. It's from the new album, the Marcus King Band, self-titled. That song is actually sort of inspired by the television show Dexter.
Yeah, a little bit. It was one of those situations I had everything but the name, you know, and kind of had all the pieces of a song, and I had never really put it together. And I think I was snowed in or something and kind of had some time to kill binge watching a show. So Dexter was that show. And there was a character on the show that, you know, I thought was underappreciated or something. And I kind of saw a lot of similarities between what I had already written and the character on the show had been going through the same kind of stuff. So
there you go.
Yeah.
Very cool. So you had done the first CD and you made connection with Warren. You know, anymore, it's like touring is the way you build a career, right? So you had this relentless touring thing happening. You were writing while you were on the road, and you basically wrote a lot of this album while you were out gigging.
Yeah, a fair share of it was written, or I'd take ideas from home and really kind of weed the good ones out while we were on the road, you know.
So Warren, you know, now is like fully involved, and he invites you all to come into the studio, and there's a lot going on in the CD. It makes it all the more surprising that you cut like 21 songs in 12 days.
Yeah, something like that. And
they were long days.
They were long days. I think after the fourth day, we actually kind of took a step back and said, whoa, we need to slow down, you know. But we cut about 21 tracks, like you said. And then, you know, the powers that be, I listened to all of them, you know, and we all kind of decided which ones were going to make the cut. And those are the ones that we focused on for the editing room and for final mix down.
About 90% of this was recorded live, though.
Yeah, all the band tracks were all recorded live, you know, with the exception of, like, pedal steel and, like, horn overdubs and, like, acoustic guitar parts and stuff like that. You know, everything was cut live, just like this.
So what was Warren like in the studio? Because he produced the record. What kind of role did he take?
Man, you know, he was so, you know, really, really easy to work with. And we had similar ideas, like I had mentioned, about what we were aiming for and really capturing the live sound that we have within the confines of a studio. So he was not like a lot of producers that'll say, you know, go in there and maybe put a little bit more punch on it. You know, it's not really any instruction or guidance, but he had really learned the songs and like knew the parts and the structure of the song well enough to where he could move parts around and explain it in such a way that we really understood it. Because we're all pretty green, you know, when it comes to the studio and going in and cutting a record for like a major label. I mean, we've never done that. So there was a lot of pressure, and obviously working with one of your heroes, there's going to be a lot of pressure. But he made it really a very good environment to work in.
You know, we've had Warren in multiple times, Derek Trucks as well. And, you know, you just get this vibe that, you know, at the heart of what they're doing for both of them individually and, of course, the things that they've done together, it's family. Mm-hmm. And at a certain level, it feels like you've sort of been brought into that family.
Not, I feel like everybody's little nephew. It's nice.
Yeah. Yeah. you know, you, I think if you're looking for like a manifestation of that, you got invited to the Big House, which is essentially the Allman Brothers Museum.
Oh, it is. Yeah. They've repurposed it and it's become the museum for the band.
And you got to, you know, is there a plural for Holy Grail, but there are a couple of guitars there.
Yeah, there are. There sure are.
And, the Hummingbird and the Gold Top.
Yeah, those two. I was invited to play the Hummingbird for an article that I was doing with, I think, Guitar Player Magazine. And they wanted me to come down and play the Hummingbird and sing a couple tunes on it. So I told my manager, I said, you ask them if the gold top's there. And they said, I already asked. They said no, but I'll ask again. So he asked, and he said that they were going to let me play it.
And, of course, these are Dwayne's guitars.
Yeah. So I played it at the big house, and it was just like, it was really, is my friend Richard is the proprietor of Dwayne's Guitars there. So we walked in, and I was expecting like, oh, we'll go back to this room here. The museum will be down, closed down, and we'll do this privately. But he walked in, and he took out his big keys, and he's like a really large, menacing, scary man. But he's real sweetheart. You know, he's a good friend of ours, yeah. And he pulls out his keys and, like, opens up a display case, like, with Dwayne's gold top in there in the Fillmore East room and, like, hands it to me. He's like, here you go, man. And I was like, whoa! You know, I didn't expect it to go down like that at all. So that was, you know. And I had just woken up and crawled out of my van and got in their van and showed up there. And that happened. So then he said, you know, I'll bring it down to the show tonight if you want to play it at the show. I said, yeah, sure.
So you played Midnight Rider on the Hummingbird.
Yeah. You know, I didn't really do the song justice, I don't think, but it was...
You're never going to feel like you do it justice, though, right? I mean, it's sort of like, how do you live up to, you know? I mean, it just...
Right. I did that one particularly because I was trying to figure out what songs could have been cut with that guitar, particularly.
Yeah.
And that was the closest one I found as far as the time range that he owned the guitar initially and the time that song was cut. It seemed plausible.
So when you were playing, correct me if I'm getting this wrong, because I had to piece this together, but when you played live, you did in memory of Elizabeth Reed?
Yeah, we sure did. My feet.
Were you happier with that one?
Yeah. Well, my feet were stuck to the ground, man. You know, it was really like an out-of-body. It was like a religious experience playing his guitar in Macon on that song, you know.
Well, it's really great that, you know, you've got this head start that you've got, and you're out making incredible music, and it's just a pleasure for us to have you in the Marcus King Band. One more song?
Absolutely, man.
Yeah.
In some faraway mystic land, a computer programmer and an English teacher are living with great regrets.
Faraway land of Athens, Georgia.
The Marcus King Band. You know, you guys are on the road, and I know you got a show tonight in St. Louis, so getting up so early to come in here and do this is a personal sacrifice for you. And sharing your artistry with us is such a blessing to us. We cannot tell you how much we appreciate it. You guys were fabulous today, and we look forward to many more visits to come if you'll grace us with your presence.
Man, absolutely. Thanks so much for having us.
Marcus King Band live this morning on the bridge.